Good evening, everyone. Thank you for sticking around for this last discussion today. We hope we can make it worth it for you guys, and even if we don't manage to make it worth it, at least, you know, think about it in context of the rest of your evening, which will be definitely improved by how bad this will turn out to be, potentially. I mean, this is, we're talking dystopian futures here, so.
Let's not accept that.
We're talking Bangalore also here, so let's. maybe you guys can each kind of take one of the mics and. So I just wanted to start actually by doing a sort of a quick audience poll. How many of you are into sci-fi or SF? Could you just, raise your hands, please? Okay, that's maybe about 15% of you. Okay, how many of you have written sci-fi or have contemplated writing, SF actually, forget sci-fi, speculative fiction in general, have you, how many of you have contemplated writing it, how many of you are planning on writing it, have written it? Show of hands, please. Okay, that's two people, amazing. Okay, so, a few more in the back, okay. So what we'll, what we're going to try and do today is, we're going to present you the possibility that, you know, possibility of all of you potentially writing SF, and we're going to kind of build a sort of framework for that, and we're going to take you through what it might, what it sort of entails to begin imagining a certain kind of a future that you can set a book in potentially. And a good context for this would be Bangalore as the Bangalore, the city of Bangalore in the future, so we can maybe, you know, we'll have a concrete example there to work with. The entire panel has been introduced now. I just want to kind of first sort of throw this question open to, like, first I'll get a sense from you guys as well. So how many of you think that you know, everyone knows what like a dystopian future is and what a utopian future is, I'm guessing. These are, I mean, concepts that do come from science fiction. How many of you think that we are sort of going to, as a city or as a world, sort of emerge into a horrible dystopian future? Show of hands, please. Okay, that's good. That's heartening. Yeah, really. That's the best show of hands so far. And how many of you are a little more hopeful and think that you know, technology can save us? Maybe, I don't know. Or maybe not technology, but we will emerge into a better, greener, lovelier future. No? Few people? Okay, a smattering, okay, safe to say. Okay, so the interesting thing is I actually had, I go once a week, I go and teach at this school where I teach art to a bunch of six and 7 year olds. And so a lot of the exercises that we do week on week is, you know, illustration related stuff, where we kind of, you know, I give them these exercises for like imagination exercises, where they have to think of something and then try and kind of illustrate it. And one of the things that I got them to do recently was exactly this, to kind of think of an urban space and think of Bangalore, for instance, and see what do you think Bangalore is going to be like in the future. And everybody drew these horrible black buildings and like smoke and dust everywhere, lots of death. These are 6 year olds, mind you. And like, some of them had no humans at all in the landscape. Some had one lone, sad human kind of wandering around among these, you know, these abandoned buildings and charred trees and things like that. So yeah, that seems to be I guess it's healthy in a way. I mean, you know, prepare for the worst, I suppose. So I wanted to start by throwing that open to the panel here today. What do you guys think is going to be, you know, what do you think the future is going to be like, and how would you imagine the future of Bangalore? And I think perhaps, you know, start by kind of giving us a general kind of sense, and then maybe get into, if you were to set a novel in this, and I'm sure, you know, many of you have possibly thought about this quite a bit, what kind of a starting point would you have, like, in terms of setting or, you know, whatever. perhaps, actually Zach is already at work on something like that. So Zach is just, he has, I don't know if you guys are aware, so he has a series of books called Mr. Majestic, and there's another, he's written this book earlier called Once Upon a Time in Scandinavistan, and both these, there's a crossover book that's going to soon happen in the future of Bangalore. So maybe you can begin with that as a context.
Yeah, you know, the thing about that dystopian, you want to take that call? Or shall I take it? Anyway, so I think like the for a dystopian novel, like Bangalore lends itself very well to that kind of a subject. And like if you talk about a utopian novel, I think you have to set it in a kind of rural place, you know, like in the Himalayas, some kind of Shangri-La type of valley. A utopian novel can, per definition, not be set in a city like Bangalore. Because we all know that Bangalore is going to cease to exist in another 10 years' time or something like that. Obviously. Okay. I mean, look at the traffic, look at the pollution, look at the fact that there's no groundwater anywhere nearby. Like in the neighborhood where I live in Bangalore, they just did like a borewell for all the houses around that, a shared borewell, 2-3 months ago, and there was water, and now it's already dry. You know, so there's like simply no groundwater left, and there's simply very little chance that Bangalore can survive more than another 10 years. Which is also like a great thing because, you know, real estate rates will go down and I'll be able to afford to buy a house 10 years from now when nobody can live in the city. Maybe except for me, I'll be that lonely person in those drawings of your 6-7-year-old students. But so I think like when we think of a city like Bangalore, there's basically like you can't think of a future for it. And partly I think it has to do with the way the city is planned or like rather not planned. And somebody in the previous panel I was listening to said something like, in Bangalore, the solutions are always worse than the problems, you know, the way they try to solve the city's problems. And like I've been here in this, I came here 27 years ago, so I've seen the city change quite a lot in that quarter century I've been here. And the one thing that struck me is that like fairly early on, already in the 90s, when my speculative mind was starting to think that something needs to be done, like I was thinking that the only possible solution for Bangalore would be to start like a second Bangalore, you know, or a third Bangalore, or a fourth Bangalore, you know, like satellite cities where you actually create new cities where people can live and work and all these things. And the old city that, like where we are right now and the cantonment part should have been preserved as an old town, like you have, say, in other countries like Paris or you know, European cities. They often have that model, keeping the central city sort of fairly clean and decent and starting satellite towns. But that kind of thing obviously cannot happen here because, you know, we're just sort of squeezing in more and more people. And I was looking at some population statistics the other day, and I think in the last census in 2011, we were about 8 million, like 85 lakh people. And now the estimate is that we're like 12.5 million people, like 1.2 crores. So that's like 50% more, you know, 4 million people have been squeezed in, and it's not even 10 years since that census. And you just imagine, you know, like 10 years from now, you'll have a population of 25 million or something like that. I mean, where will you fit all these people? And think about the cars, you know, Bangalorians, apparently like every other family has a car, you know, and then, so at that point, you'll have what, like 15 million cars squeezing in here? Like, we'll basically be, I actually heard about a short film made by some local filmmaker, which was, struck me as like a wonderful image of the future of Bangalore. It's about this family who gets stuck in this couple who gets stuck in a traffic jam, or they meet in a traffic jam, they get married, they stay in the car, they have children in the car, and the traffic jam never moves, and they grow old in that car. You know, that is like...
I'm sure this is already happening at Silkboard though.
Probably.
Like seeking matrimonial alliance, preferably from the same traffic jam. No, but I mean, I'm glad you said the label you used was speculative fiction and not science fiction, right. But because for me, dreaming of good pothole-free roads and good public transport seems less science fiction and more like an urban fantasy. Right? But I sort of don't like the binary between dystopia and utopia. To paraphrase what William Gibson said about the future, dystopias are already here. Yeah. It's just unevenly distributed. Yeah. Right? So the people who hang out in, say, level roads and the brigade roads and all, for them, it's all nice, right? Right?
And often in a lot of these novels and films which are set in supposedly utopian societies, they're dystopias in disguise, basically.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, because for the top level, yeah, right, it's always a utopia. But you go down to Mysore Road during the monsoons, there's no power, right? The sewage is overflowing and the water is coming to your house, right? And everything is gone. And there's no approach roads. Here, they are living in a dystopia today, right? So this hard boundaries between utopias and dystopias is something that I don't subscribe to. But that said, I'm a great believer in hopeful futures, right? If you start, I mean, as people who imagine or create or whatever, it's up to us, I feel, or up to all of you who create, to put out hopeful futures out there. Right? So that you spark the imagination of the younger generation. Right? You give them a sense of optimism that there is something worth living for.
Not just scare the shit out of them.
No, no. I mean, they have enough problems to deal with. Right? Why bung this on to them? So for me, I would say that yes, given political will and all that sort of a thing, the concept of well-implemented smart cities with technology and data and all of that is perhaps in the next 10-15 years going to make Bangalore a more livable place. I won't say better, right? Because like I said, depends on who you ask, but more livable. That's what I feel.
So this is, I mean, this also is dependent on political will to some extent, I guess.
I disagree a little with Roy about the smart city Kool-Aid. we've been actually working on a project called Gendering the Smart City, which looks at smart city policy. And it's amazing because smart city policy almost everywhere in the world, but definitely in India, completely ignores gender as a vector. So the assumption is that everybody experiences the city in the same way, which of course is really far from the truth. So I mean, of course there is advocacy that one needs to do, and as you very rightly say, that if we don't imagine possible interventions, then we will never change anything. But technology and the role of data in the smart city, I think, can be potentially quite dangerous because, you know, whose hands that data is in, how do we legislate for that data, are all questions that we have to, you know, as a civil society, really fight for and actually be informed enough to fight against in order to make any kind of shift. So, yeah.
No, that's what I mean. One, you look at the problems, right? But then you can't go around living in the problems. Like you said, I mean, you then start working towards putting sort of safeguards in place, right? And then that's how you try to, I mean, if you just throw up your hands and say, no, okay, Bangalore's going to be unlivable in 10 years or 15 years or whatever, nobody's going to do anything about it. Right.
And I totally agree with you about the young people dystopia thing. Like Hunger Games, I think, was such an amazing example of showing young people how to triumph against the system. And I think, you know, in video games as well, I mean, what's amazing is that dystopia is the space you start from, but it's, you know, the hero or the heroine who makes that difference, who takes one more step closer to utopia, right? And you realize that the whole system cannot change. It is not going to be overwhelming structural change. But, you know, one person, a few people can make that difference. And, yeah, I guess that's very encouraging for younger people to hear. Absolutely.
I mean, the Pareto principle operates everywhere, right? It's the, yeah, you know about the Pareto principle, right? Everything is 80-20. So you have those, the 80% of the non-believers, you know, dooms the, you know, prophets and stuff like that. And you have the 20% who will sort of pull everybody along, you know, and that's what I hope for. I mean, I love dystopian literature. It's lovely. That's because that's from where we draw cautionary lessons, right? It's like Ray Bradbury said about Fahrenheit 451. I was not trying to predict the future, I was trying to prevent it, right? Or you take the case of Handmaid's Tale, right? Even in the Handmaid's Tale, Atwood has said that nothing that's there in Handmaid's Tale is nothing that hadn't happened at in some country in Europe in some form or the other. But by putting this out there, you sort of make sure you tell people that, hey, listen, this is what you need to look out for. This is how, these are the early warning signs of, say, fascism. These are the early warning signals of, say, authoritarianism, right? In that, dystopian literature has great value.
But are you in also saying that it could potentially become like a self-fulfilling prophecy by putting just a lot of this out there and not enough of...
Yeah, we have, that's what, we have to balance it with hopeful visions of the future. Right. Otherwise, like you saw, seen those placards in the U.S. women's rights marches, which happened. Right. And there were a lot of placards which said, you know, The Handmaid's Tale is not an instruction manual. Right. So that is exactly why I say that we need to balance these, you know, doomsday futures, visions of doomsday futures with hopeful, more optimistic visions.
I'm glad you brought up the the protests, actually, because one of the, you know, tropes of this sort of fiction is that, you know, there is, as you were talking about Hunger Games, there's often, you know, there's a certain kind of society and then there's always a, some sort of a revolution that happens to overthrow that. And that seems to be the sort of dominant mode for, I mean, what remains of the left these days, you know, which is to kind of go on these huge mass protests and, you know, that sort of thing. And then and one of the criticisms also of these, you know, mass protests that have been happening over the last few years is what they, you know, now they're being termed as folk politics, which is, you know, which is very sort of, it's all about the grassroots, it's all about hyperlocalism, it's all about all of that, and then, but not sufficiently paying attention to the fact that the capitalist sort of, you know, the globalized sort of system is so entrenched that the only way to possibly change that would be to actively work with it. And, you know, make policy level changes. And that is something that, you know, I think people who are leading protests are probably not doing enough of. I mean, the classic case, of course, is Occupy, which just sort of fizzled out in the end where, you know, I mean, it made a mark in terms of, you know, sounding like making people heard. But then beyond that, what did it do in terms of, you know, actual change or, you know, many similar things.
I'd just like to make a small point also here. Yeah. That we shouldn't necessarily view dystopia as a bad thing, you know, or dystopian literature. We should see it for the positive values that it has, because, I mean, it is useful to get scared. You know, like we watch horror movies, let's say Texas Chainsaw Massacre, if you've seen that. Anybody familiar with Texas Chainsaw Massacre? To me, I mean, like lots of people feel it's a horrible film because they butcher humans in it. But to me, it's like a fantastic film advocating vegetarianism, if you think about it. You know, like, because you, through these humans who are butchered in the film, you get to experience what the animals feel, no, when they're slaughtered. You know, or you can at least put yourself in the shoes of a, you know, that tandoori chicken before it went into the tandoor. So, like, likewise, I think dystopian literature or films can actually help us work with, you know, our sort of apprehensions about where society is heading. And on some level, I mean, there's been a lot of dystopian films, for example, coming out of Hollywood in the last few decades. And at parallel to that, you've had these trends of people starting like urban gardening and, you know, things to create more oxygen in their neighborhoods and that kind of thing. So I think there is some kind of a sort of a relationship there. I mean, I suspect. Maybe we can talk more about it later during this panel.
Okay. So you want to add something?
No, I mean, I'm the doom and gloom guy here. I'm the one who shows up with the sandwich board that says the end is nigh. So I'm still going to keep listening and then hold up my sign at some point. Yeah. So it's,
yeah, I mean, I am too, which is, I have, for years I've been thinking, yeah, we're heading for a garbage apocalypse, so,
No, I mean, it's, this thing is, okay, so, this is good, but it's like, you know, when people said the world is going to end in 2012 or whatever, you know, brilliant, I mean, we so believe that the world is going to, but it still didn't stop paying the premium for the insurance policy. Right? Yes, so there is, while it's one thing to actually say doom and gloom and stuff like that, but look at what we do in our actual day-to-day lives. I mean, do you really believe, or do you want it to happen? Right? Do you want, let me put this question out. Fine, dystopias may look inevitable going by the majority, but how many of you honestly would want to live in a dystopia? Who wants to live in a dystopia? Fictionally speaking, it looks like it's inevitable, but we don't want to live in a dystopia. Nobody wants to live in a dystopia. So, describe a dystopia, right?
Bangalore. this
sort of neatly brings me to my next question, which is, if you were to describe a Bangalore of the future, and this is specifically with regard to world building, because, you know, which is like the first part of really, you know, writing an SF novel, which is having a world that is sufficiently both credible and incredible, where you can sort of, you know, you can exist in it and assimilate the things that are going on in it without questioning the rules of that world, but at the same time, you know, it is speculative. So perhaps, you know, you guys can kind of talk a little bit about world building and about, you know, how you would go about constructing either a dystopia or a utopia.
So for me, it's all about resources, right? It's about scarcity or the plenty of resources. So when you design a video game, for example, the thing that you're dealing with is resource management, right? Like, you know, how much health can you gain before things run out, or, you know, so on and so forth. But what I often find, and I think smarter video games deal with this, by the way, I'm talking about video games because that's what I make. I don't write sci-fi, so I'm just specifying that. One reason why we look at that and kind of an interesting kind of intersection with that is that it's never fait accompli. So yesterday when Aroma Ravi was talking about how inevitable the ruin of the world, not only Bangalore, is, I read an article shortly afterwards about overpopulation and its relationship with women and women's education. Right, so the more you educate women, the less likely they are to have children. And women's education is undeniably on the rise. So if that keeps going at the rate it is, and at a more accelerated rate than it is, then this threat of overpopulation is actually going to probably stop.
To set it in the present, because, you know, it people would immediately start reading it and say, but this is not the present. So, I mean, you have to set it a little bit in the future, but not too far in the future, like within our sort of lifetimes, depending on if we survive Bangalore traffic today. Anyway, so
for those who may not be familiar, counterfactual narrative is something that's set in a world similar to ours, but where one integral aspect of it has changed. It could be something political, it could be something technology that's not there, something like that.
And yeah, yeah. So in this case, I mean, I started with the idea of global warming and what its effect could be on Europe. And that sort of led me into thinking also that you wouldn't only have global warming destroying the European landscape and turning most of it into sort of continuation of the Sahara Desert, but you would also need something else, and that led me to the idea of, you know, reverse colonialism, where in fact India has taken over Europe and sort of not like in a sort of a military colonization or occupation or anything like that, but it's more like I started imagining the European countries going very bankrupt, and for example, I come from Sweden, no, and nobody knows the difference between Sweden and Switzerland. So like when Switzerland is sold off to Indian super capitalists, then Sweden is sort of goes, you know, as a sort of a in the bargain. And so you have this situation where, you know, the Indian administrative service is sort of has to deal with a, you know, morally and financially bankrupt country like Sweden. And so that said, you know, that was the sort of function and which I was then had to look for a form to how to, you know, interpret that vision of an alternative future. So did that make sense at all?
Yeah, it did.
Yeah. Oh, strange.
I wanted to ask, we've been talking a lot about technology and, you know, that being the, I mean, obviously you're saying That's like a, if you're thinking of it as a house, then that's the structure of it. But I mean, at the end of the day, the good science fiction or good speculative fiction is also something that comments on the human condition. So the house has to be inhabited by someone. So I was just wondering, actually, I wanted to also, you know, talk about, so since we're also situating it in specific places, so you were talking about Sweden and so on. So if you're talking about like choosing to pick certain cultural aspects of a place and, you know, and certain things that inform that place, you know, how would, where that sort of thinking kind of emerges when you're starting to write? And you, so Shalini, you were saying that you usually start with a character in mind. So I'm just going to shamelessly plug this book. There's this book that I that I edited recently. It's a science fiction anthology called Strange World, Strange Times. And so Sunando, Shalini, and Zach have all contributed short stories to it. So there's a short story that Shalini had written, which is set in, is it present day Bangalore? Is it right?
I didn't really work that out. That's straight and gentle.
Right. But you've turned dolmens, which are these, you know, these ancient architectural things. With, I mean, they're like... Is Stonehenge a dolmen? It is,
no,
right?
Dolmens are that shape where you have two rocks and a roof over it. So that's the sort of classic dolmen shape.
Right. So you turn that into some sort of a portal, like a, into a parallel world. So perhaps you can just talk a little bit about how, you know, the humans, I mean, when you're thinking about this, how, you know, technology is not, I mean, is not necessarily something that informs the entire narrative, but something that heightens it maybe.
Well, this is partly because I mostly write fantasy, not science fiction. So even when I'm writing speculative fiction, it tends to veer towards, oh, I can't explain that, it just happened. So this is partly why. But also, I think the way I write, I always start with character. And with from character, I move outwards to landscape, technology, if relevant, but other social situations. So, I mean, when I think about dystopias, utopias, I always think of them in terms of how is it affecting specific people at different positions. I mean, you were talking about how what's utopia for if you're top of the food chain is probably a dystopia if you're elsewhere. And I think, like, a lot of my favorite fiction does this thing where you probably get to look at this from both angles, right? You get to sort of do top-down, but you also get to see people who are at the wrong end of the utopia. So I think that's how character really helps, because ultimately a lot of writing is about who you empathize with. And
Shunando, you want to just add something? I wanted to also ask, so Shunando has been, you know, working with Shunando has been working with Image Comics, which has actually been producing some of the most exciting science fiction narratives in the comic form in recent times. Some amazing books, and you've also been working quite some time, and you've done a lot of science fiction comics, and you've been kind of a student of comics for several years. I wanted to also look at comics as a medium and how it's kind of different in, because you were talking about gaming, and that's actually another, you know, now I think it's probably another dominant form right now, but comics is possibly on the way, and I'm not entirely sure. You know, you could possibly talk a little bit more about that, because a lot of the rock star comic writers of the past are now sort of moving into film and, you know, that sort of thing. But talk about how the visual medium kind of is different in, you know, storytelling and world building as well, how that kind of changes over there. And then also comment a little bit about the collaborative nature of that, because there you have groups of people telling stories together. So there are groups of people who are kind of building these worlds.
Well, see, comics was always the visual medium for people who couldn't afford to make movies. You know, you can't afford special effects, learn how to draw. I mean, it's that old joke about the difference between writing a comic and drawing a comic is that the writer says 100 million spaceships appear, but then some idiot has to sit and draw 100 million spaceships. I think a lot of that's changing, I suppose, because these days comics have kind of become, it's a place where you create IP that then gets adapted into other mediums. More people watch Marvel movies than read Marvel comics. Rocket Raccoon is a household name, but Rocket Raccoon's been around since the 80s and none of us cared till last year. I still I think most people tend to associate comics with superheroes. That's completely changed now. If you look at most of the comics that are popular, the highest selling comic that's not published by DC or Marvel is a book called Saga. Has anyone here read it? Okay.
Image book,
Saga has a very strange, unfortunate Bangalore connection now, because it's a comic with a lot of graphic sex and violence, and they were handing out freebies at the Bangalore Comic Con, including to small children. And some parents then lodged an FIR against Comic Con India saying, what is this? Because it just opens with like a very graphic sex scene. So there you go. But Saga is a book that sells in the millions, which kind of started this thing that people call the image revolution, which is image comics. Unfortunately, it's led to this whole thing where now everyone's trying to write the next Saga. And you have specialist science fiction comic publishers like Vault Comics, who are currently doing some great stuff. It's always been like, I think comics will always be like this weird, like halfway genre. It's never medium. It's never going to be dominant right. As such. It's not profitable enough. Right. You're selling comics for like $4 a piece. A movie ticket is $10. Right. Movie budgets are way higher. Unfortunately, it's always going to be.
Does it allow you narratively to take more risks? Because it's not as.
Sort of does, because not enough people are looking. You know? So you kind of do your own thing. It's different because now people are hoping that, you know, someone's going to read my comic, some producer's going to look at it and then option it and give me. Because you do have things like The Walking Dead, for anyone who watches it, started out as a comic. Not many people knew that. And it's a comic that was going to be cancelled. It was selling, I think, something like 3,000 copies, barely profitable, and now it's like this billion-dollar franchise with its own spin-offs and video games and everything.
There is a certain kind of weird comic that's now kind of getting out there. I mean, with things which you wouldn't have seen in the mainstream earlier. I mean, earlier something like a Superman or a Batman, okay, you know, it's you can kind of see it somehow, but you mentioned Rocket Raccoon, but yeah. but similar to that, I mean, you have, you know, now there's a you know, now you have like a Teen Titans TV show, and you have you know, all kinds of like, I mean, but there's a lot of stranger characters in from the fringes who seem to be kind of, there's a Swamp Thing TV show coming about.
I think a lot of that has to do with throwing things at a wall and seeing what sticks. These things are going to be profitable enough anyway that you can make. I mean, there's never going to be a flop as such. Like, even the worst Netflix show has. I actually have no idea about Netflix numbers. I shouldn't have brought that up. But there's enough people that watch it that it works out for them. Right. I read this thing about one of the Avengers movies where they had, even though they had like a multi-billion-dollar budget, they'd made their money off licensing and advertising long before the movie released. And then it went on to being one of the highest grossing movies of all time. So where's the risk?
What I'm trying to understand actually is where the sort of trade-off happens, and where, so earlier, you know, in the 80s and so on, I think, you know, some of the riskiest narratives were happening in comics.
I think if you want to look at risky narratives, I don't think the mainstream is where you're.
And again, you know, specifically with regard to, you know, this conversation that we're having, what, you know, it at least maybe also focusing a little bit on, you know, urban sort of, you know, SF and so on, where perhaps you can kind of give us some idea of like the kind of interesting risks that or strange kind of departures that comics have taken from, let's say, mainstream, you know, literary, speculative fiction or science fiction. I'm not sure if there is, these kind of things have happened, maybe because it's visual. And actually, this is open to you guys are all comics people. So Padmini and Shalini are all like, I mean, people who've deeply studied comics and who've kind of.
So, I mean, you've obviously got your V for Vendetta and Alan Moore. And I mean, you know, I think that's interesting because the difference seems to be between comics and graphic novels, which are, you know, immediately seen as an elevated form. But all a graphic novel is a collected, you know, a version of or collection of comics, right? But I think what the visual medium allows is, say, the double page spread. I mean, the kind of impact of, you know, two pages next to each other and the cityscape as the double page spread. I mean, we've been seeing that, you know, since Batman, right? Like, you know, Gotham City is another character in Batman. And I think, you know, that kind of space allows for, you know, us to both see the city in the microcosm, because you'll turn the page and there'll be something very, you know, close up or something, a hand, and then on the next page it'll be something zoomed out, right? So I think the kind of flexibility of sequential art where, and also because as a reader you can make up, you know, what's happening in the gaps, right? Like the breaths between each panel is also, you know, something that the reader, co-constructs with the author. So I think, you know, sequential art as a medium just allows for that much potential to look at the city in really different ways and at different scales, right?
Gotham City is a good example because, I mean, in DC, Gotham and Metropolis are basically the utopia and the dystopia and the utopia versions of New York, I guess, right?
But, so, and what I think is super interesting is that they have now become paradigms for the way that we in real life think about the city. So, you know, the utopian, shiny, you know, kind of frictionless city is, you know, it's a sci-fi imagination that brought us there, right? And I think we need to see more realistic, more organic versions of future cities. I think, you know, our imagination has been quite limited by what we've seen in sci-fi, and there needs to be maybe more, you know, more thinking around, you know, how, again, how do women experience the city, or how, you know, how much greener a city could be rather than it being technocentric, which is, you know, often the kind of the paradigm of the utopian future city, right? Which is a sci-fi vocabulary thing. Yeah.
Coming back to what you were talking about, have you by any chance read All Quiet in Vikaspuri, Sanatan? So that's actually, like, I mean, when you mentioned what this panel was, that was the first thing I thought about, because that is a comic set in a future Delhi with a water crisis. And most of the comic is just people running around, digging underground, looking for water. And of course, there's war breaking out, all kinds of terrible and also very absurd things happen. But I think it sort of reminded me a little bit of what you said also. And one of the nice things that I like that this comic does is that there is a water crisis, but there's also all these, and I think the visual medium allows you to sort of have two or three stories happening simultaneously. So water crisis, terrible things happening, war breaking out, people are planting cannons on their roofs. But also there's all these little absurd bits which provided some amount of hopefulness even in this terrible dystopia. So,
yeah, that's very interesting. And I was thinking also something you said about the city being a character in the, and it occurred to me now that, like, especially in the kind of literature we're talking about, the city or the landscape that we use is actually a very important character in these stories, like maybe more than in a typical story set in the present, you know, like more like a normal story, or if we can, if we can talk about something like normal story. Anyway, so the city as a character, then I was just thinking, like, as a writer, then what one does is one kind of looks for various clues, possibly in the present, possibly in history, maybe, and you think about, like, okay, in history, if the A has led to B, what will C? Point C, B, then, and you kind of build up a sort of network of ideas as you're writing or before you're writing, depending on your working methods, and start connecting the dot. And that's, I think, like, where the writer's creative imagination comes, like where you start connecting these dots, which you've been sort of, looking these clues and where it might lead to. And so the thing that happens in this circumstance is, I think that, like, as one connects these dots and does this novel or makes this graphic novel or comic or whatever, one creates a scope for a kind of a sort of aha type of experience. So like when somebody reads that thing, who has been thinking broadly on those same lines, but not fully, you know, drawn those same conclusions. In these works that we are doing, we are offering those a sort of possible conclusion. And that, I think, is like the great thing for the readers, that sort of, you know, oh, wow, you know, that sort of experience you can get sometimes when you read something really good.
So coming back to cities and all of that, I mean, one thing you know is that each city has its own character. Mumbai has its own character, Calcutta has its own character and all that. But this, the sort of multiplicity of experiences that we see in a city, right, unfortunately has not translated well into sort of fiction so far. I mean, for example, like you said, you know, metropolis is a shortcut for a utopia. This thing, there's no 50 shades of gray in between, right? So if you look at Bangalore,
I think they are kind of building that in. I mean, that used to be, I think, the 50s and the 60s.
They're trying. So, if you had to talk about Bangalore,
right?
The mistake that most of us make is that we speak of Bangalore as this one monolithic entity.
Right.
The Bangalore of Chamrajpet is not the Bangalore of Indiranagar.
Absolutely.
Is not the Bangalore of Whitefield, even if you can call Whitefield Bangalore.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Or Koramangala, for example. Koramangala, if I would had to add, geographically situated in the north of India, but fair enough. So there are so many Bangalores. So the treatment of this multiplicity of a city, to me, the gold standard is Italo Calvino's Invisible Cities.
Right.
Right. It's a brilliant book. If you guys haven't read it, you should read it. It's by this author called Italo Calvino, and it's the story of Marco Polo's comeback from his amazing travel to the Orient and all, and he's been asked to describe the, you know, all the cities that he's been to, and he starts, right? So he describes one city, and then he describes another city which is totally different, then he describes a third city with a different character, and then you realize that all of those cities that he's been describing, these are, that's where it takes the title from, are descriptions from various perspectives of the same single city, right? So that sort of, you know, broad perspective, rather than just like cutting it into black and white, to me is something that, you know, fiction and sort of imagining futures should factor into.
In fact, one of the, I mean, there's this nonfiction collection of essays called Multiple City, which is about Bangalore, right? Multiple City. Which Zach has also contributed to. And that, I think the premise is exactly this, which is how, I mean, how do you identify the soul of a city?
I mean, that's more like an anthology, really, with different writers writing about a city.
Right. I think the sort of thesis of that is also that you can't really pinpoint a specific personality
in Bangalore, in particular. I mean, that's probably what the title refers to. Like all the other books in that series are more specific. You know, the book on Delhi and Calcutta and Bombay.
You're talking about the new Aleph books.
No. That was also part of
the
series.
Oh, even there was a series, is it?
Penguin did, you know. Okay. The Bombay was like Bombay Mary Jan, you know, like right. Bombay my love. Right. I mean, all love. No, Bangalore was more complex.
But it's interesting because, you know, even if you say something like Bombay Mary Jan or whatever, you know, like Calcutta sort of, I think for most of us, conjures up a certain image of, you know, I mean, I don't know what exactly it is.
Be
but
careful,
there is,
I'm from Calcutta.
I know, I mean, I love the city.
I'm from Calcutta.
It's a lovely city, but there is an image associated. I mean, you think of it a certain way. The Bombay kind of, you know, there is a Bombay that lives in a lot of people's minds. So I don't know. I mean, through in fiction, at least, you know, through over the years, whether, and maybe Shenoy, you can kind of shed some light on this, whether there has been any sort of a depiction of Bangalore, which is, at least, I mean, if it doesn't, you know, maybe it doesn't have the same personality, but maybe the soul is a Bangalorean soul. I don't know.
See, Bangalore, I've been here in the city for almost 20 plus years now, and I've seen this city change, you know, from what they used to call pensioners' paradise, and, you know, lots of gardens and greenery, and people had time to stop and smell the roses and all this sort of thing, and we don't do it anymore because there are no roses left.
Today I heard somebody say that instead of garden city, it's called garbage city.
But if you look at the way Bangalore is treated in Kannada literature, right? In Kannada literature, it's rooted in the traditions and the languages of it, and you get this whole warm, fuzzy picture of Bangalore, right? If you look at contemporary mentions of Bangalore in English literature, be it science fiction, comics, or whatever it is, it's about this sort of young, you know, happening, high-tech city and all this sort of a thing. So to me, the character or the treatment of Bangalore in literature and all has changed in keeping pace with how the city has changed. So that's a good marker
of how... Could you give us a couple of examples maybe of, you know, how it has been treated in Kannada?
So for example, if you read some of the books of, some of the stories of Kaikini and all of those, right? Or how Shivram Karant refers to Bangalore and all that sort of a thing. Or for that matter, if you look at it, Malgudi, right? Now, Arkanarayan came up with the name Malgudi because he loved Bangalore, and the name Malgudi is a portmanteau of Malleshwaram and Basangudi, right? So that sort of idyllic approach, you know, of everybody knowing each other, of that sort of sameness, you know, a sense of community and all of that, these kind of things are there in Kannada literature. In English literature, it's always about this one hero who's changing tech or whatever. So the other day I was reading up about this story by this Sri Lankan author called Yudhanjaya Vijayaratne and this Indian origin author called RRVD. So they've written a story set in the future, which is a bit of, you know, Pacific Rim in India, right? Yeah, it's called The Messenger. So the premise of that is, you know, about the comet Oumuamua, which came out, right? So the premise of the story is that that's an alien spacecraft which has been sent to sort of, you know, recce Earth's defenses. And finding that there are none, the next year the invading fleet follows and stuff like that. And then we have our Indian boys and stuff like that in Bangalore, you know, the high-tech city of Bangalore, you know, churning out these big, you know, mecca and all of those things. So the Bangalore there is completely high-tech and futuristic and all of those things. So if you look, one is the language, because English literature mostly sort of ignores the cultural aspects of the city, because a language brings something to, you know, when you know, if you know Kannada and when you speak Kannada, it brings with it its own idioms, its own phrasing, its own culture, its own cultural reference points. English doesn't have that. So to me, the treatment of Bangalore in English is very sterile. It treats people well and has a human story and all, but it's very, to me, sterile. Whereas in Kannada literature, it's, I mean, probably because it's the culture that I come from, but it feels nice and warm, and that's the kind of Bangalore I want to go back to.
This is interesting, because I think Zach's book, the Mr. Majestic series, is actually, it's
kind of an interesting variation on this, but I don't think it really is your standard English, you know, treatment of, possibly also because you've been here for how many years now, 28?
27.
Yeah, and you lived for a large part of that time when you first came here in Majestic, right, in around that age period. So.
Well, I was staying there in a hotel for some time, but I mean, then not for too long. Well, it became like my sort of personal urban nostalgia. So like even if I was living in here in Sadashiv Nagar or nearer to Hebbal where I'm staying now, it was always the place where I would go, you know, for literary inspiration.
Which is quite different from your cantonment Bangalore, you know, of English literature.
Yeah, true. Actually, like when I was been listening to you guys here, I was started to get like a plot idea or a story idea for a futuristic Bangalore story. I'll just try it out on you guys if you think it's worth writing. So, like I was just thinking, you know, you were saying that you've been staying here for 20 years, and like I've been here 27 years. So, like we've been sort of drinking this borewell water, which is largely poisoned, and breathing this polluted air, which is largely, I mean, very harmful for us, and eating quite a lot of like gobi manchurian, I imagine, which is like known as the unofficial national dish of Bangalore. I was just thinking, like, imagine somebody spending 20 years in Bangalore and you know, like all your blood system would be full of all this pollution, no? Like a mixture of bovell water, pollution, air pollution, and Gobi Manchurian. And like, imagine what kind of Frankenstein type of monster that would be like. Like this person would be like a metaphor for this city, you know? And when sort of, just sort of tweak it a little bit more, no? Like things start sprouting from the head of that, you know, like flyovers coming out of the head and things, you know, not to speak of what happens below the belt. So, I mean, would that be like an interesting story idea?
Oh, that would be. I mean, that the person then becomes a sort of microcosm of the city.
Right.
Of the city with, you know, wards, potholes and all.
And then the property prices would fall because no one would want to live there. So you'd...
I mean, what do you guys think? I mean, if would you read a story like that? Would you pay for a story like that? more importantly.
Write a story like that. That also, because I mean, part of the point is also whether. Can you not hear? No, that's fine. So,
I mean, the point also is to kind of maybe get you guys to think a little bit about the act of writing these kind of stories. So, you know, do these kind of, you know, the things that we're talking about, does it sort of, you know, get, does it make you think a little bit about, you know, how to maybe speculate?
Yeah. I mean, there are
a certain parallel Bangalore into being. I mean, I don't know. And perhaps, you know, it's a worthwhile sort of a mental exercise to kind of maybe, you know, at some point just close your eyes and just think about your journey in Bangalore and how, you know, and just how you imagine Bangalore at this point. And then, you know, looking at the last 10 or 20 or how many ever years you've been in Bangalore and having experienced it changing in this way, how you think, you know, a similar kind of change might kind of extend into the future and where it might end up. So, you know, that might be an interesting way to kind of think about the setting for a book that you may write maybe.
And something that I wanted to flag up was just representation. So, I mean, I'm really glad Shenoy brought up vernacular. But it's also about, like, who's writing and, right? And who we read, like, who gets published. And so, you know, many kind of dystopian worlds that aren't apparent to us or visible to us of people of non-dominant caste communities, etc., because we are not reading their experiences of the city, our kind of vision or our imagination, again, is very limited. So, I mean, ideally, in a kind of, I guess, in an ideal republic of letters, you have a kind of range of voices that kind of articulate what the city could be and is in order for people, because I think, you know, it's very, I don't think there's a moral judgment here at all. It's just that it's very difficult for anybody to imagine the life of another. And that's what fiction allows, right? And so, you know, that's a space where one can kind of explore and represent.
Because as much as it is about, you know, the vernacular and so on, I think you, can you hear me back there?
Yeah.
I mean,
sorry.
So, no, as much as it is about, you know, about the local experience, the existing cultures and the vernaculars, I think, you know, one can't also discount the migrant experience, which is now, you know, so much of Bangalore is migrant
and it's just as valid.
Absolutely. And from all, you know, economic strata and, you know, all, I mean, and working in all kinds of sectors and, you know, people. And I mean, obviously the experience of Bangalore for each of these people, as you're saying, is...
Yesterday, I don't know, some people may have been here for Chanakya Vyas's panel where he's written a play called Algorithms, which is this amazing exploration of Uber drivers. And it's based on lots of interviews with Uber drivers, a kind of ethnographic study. And many of the Uber drivers that are represented in the play are from different parts of the country. And one thing that he flags up is how fast they start speaking Kannada. Now, I've lived here now for 4 years, and I have, because I'm, you know, my privilege of being around people who understand me all the time, I've not picked up Kannada as well as I should have. But, you know, because they come from the class that they do, they have to pick up the language, right? And so, you know, so just the migrant experience and also the way they navigate. I mean, I'm increasingly fascinated by how Google Maps mediates our idea of the city. Right, like how our understanding of the city is now being completely mediated by data. Like we can't even think about going to a place. Like I can't imagine having moved here as a person who had never really lived in Bangalore at all without the help of technology. But it does mean that I'm seeing the city only through what Google shows me, which is, you know, very dangerous because it covers many other existences.
Yeah. And that sort of reminds me about how, you know, I've seen this thing just from my experience of giving directions to people.
Yeah.
Right? So once upon a time, I would say, okay, listen, go down, Velar Junction, take a right, at the, just behind Crown Cafe, and the other person is now blinking at me. What Velara? Who Crown? Right? Divars in Cantonment was a landmark. You know, okay, you're going down, right? And the thing goes straight, just after Divars, take you. Divars? Right? Kohit Cafe. Right? Victoria. All of these places are just sort of gone. So those are the sort of, they were part of our language, they were part of our experience, they're completely gone. And with that, the old city is gone. But
just a thing to add to this, which is, we've been talking a lot about the old city, yes. But one of the things I haven't seen in fiction and I would like to, is the places that 5 years ago were villages. And now suddenly they're at the heart of Bangalore. Mm. Right? There's a shiny new mall where your field was 2 years ago. What happens to those people? Like, that's something I would really like to see in fiction, and I don't think
still,
I have.
It's not there, but we still manage. See, for example, my house is in a place called Devar Chikanalli, right? Which is 2 kilometers inside from Bommanalli and 2 kilometers inside this side from Bilekhalli. I've been living there I've been living there for about 7 years, and all the people have been living there for 20-25 years. And I mean, generally talking to them, and they used to say that, you know, till about 20 years ago, they would say, oh, yenappa, Bengaluru hogta idiya? You know, just 20 odd years ago. But now it's middle of the city. Property prices are 7,000, 8,000 rupees a square foot and all this sort of thing. But the people have still managed to hold on to the culture. Right? For example, this weekend, the Halli Jatra is happening under the banyan tree. Right? So which means all those small kadlepuri stalls and all of those things and those old merry-go-rounds which we associate with village fairs, it's a proper Halli Jatra. So that to me is a sort of indicator of today's Bangalore, where you have a Halli Jatre, right, in the middle of this shiny metropolis called Bangalore, right? So that sort of brings me to what you were telling about how do we imagine future cities and all that sort of a thing. So, I mean, if I may just sort of give a brief framework of this thing. So, this is a framework which is used in futurism and strategic foresight and stuff like that in science fiction and for mapping of futures. Usually it is done by futurists on commission from brands and for companies and all that sort of a thing. But you can use it also to sort of write fiction. Because if you start with just one point, like you get 2 choices. Or you give people 3 choices, they'll go for the middle one. So this one gives you 4. Right? So divide a space into 4 quadrants. Right? So on one axis, and let's look at it from the perspective of Bangalore. On one axis, you have high wealth and low wealth. And another axis, you have high technology and you have low technology. And what these 4 quadrants does is usually gives you a choice one likes, one choice that one agrees with, one choice that you don't like, and one choice that is weird. Right? So there's one quadrant which is high tech, high wealth, right? Which probably everybody likes. Then there is high tech, low wealth, which possibly people agree with because of the inequalities and all. Then you have high wealth, low technology, which is the weird one. How does that work? Right? There's a lot of money, a lot of wealth, but there's no technology. And the undesirable future is the low technology, low wealth. So depending on where you would want to situate, if this is your starting point, so how does it come to be that the Bangalore of 10 years from now is high wealth but low technology? It's just a framework to start thinking, right, as interested futurists or want to just sort of this thing. Every writer has their own way of going about it, but this is just one framework that we can do. So, I mean, just think about it. A Bangalore which is high wealth, low tech, it's kind of weird. So if that's your future 10 years from now, what's our future 10 years from now, how would that have come to be? What would have changed?
And this is actually, you can also use the same kind of framework. I think there is a Kurt Vonnegut. Kurt Vonnegut used to
the structure of story.
The story structure thing, right? Yeah. Which is like a similar kind of a graph.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think you can sort of use this also and map. I may add like certain odd points along this and kind of map similar things there. So I mean, Vonnegut, you had this story graph where you know you had similar strange things. I mean, I can't remember now. It's been quite some time since I saw the lecture, but it's a famous lecture. You can look it up on YouTube, and it kind of follows the graph of a story. And so you, I think he gives the example of the Cinderella.
Yeah,
story,
it's
for example. Right?
So Kurt Vonnegut's story structure is not so much a framework as it is a mapping of the overall flow of every plot ever. Of every plot ever. So if you, so it starts off with hardship, right? So you root for the character and then something good happens and you're like, yay, the character is going and something nice is happening. Boom, something bad happens and then she goes back and you feel bad. And then things get worse and they hit rock bottom. You're like rooting for the character. You're seriously, oh, what is going on? And then suddenly the fairy godmother comes and she comes up and they all live happily ever after. Right, so as they say, you know, there's only like 8 basic plot points in the world. Right. What you do with them is where the genius of writers and creators like you comes in.
I was just going to add that there's already some very interesting high-tech, high-wealth, utopian fiction being written about Bangalore. It's the state government's Twitter account, if any of you follow that. So it's,
I mean, yeah, see, that is good fiction. That is very good fiction.
And you should see the photos after that. It writes itself, really. So it's,
I think it's a good point to maybe open out the thing for questions. So if anyone has any questions, please feel free to ask.
Bangalore, science fiction.
Storytelling, anything? Science fiction, Bangalore, anything, really.
Marvel movies.
Rocket
and Marvel movies, comics, anything. I mean, really.
Gobi Manchurian, yeah.
Yeah, Gobi Manchurian also.
You can ask questions or even state.
Again, if you have to ask about Gobi Manchurian, please specify. It's the with or without ogarne variety.
I was particularly thinking of science fiction. Why does not it end up with a very happy note, as you said, even in the panelists, you tend to find it that we talked about dystopian thing. And yeah, so why not in the positive note sort of thing? And second question that comes to my mind is that what becomes popular is also, I don't know, means I think that it's more coming from very definite plot of some high-tech technology or something that is alien, but not from the realistic situation as you talked about that crisis of water. Means these novels don't tend to become popular. Why is it so, though we face it quite often?
I would sort of answer that by saying, follow the money, right? So dystopias are in. Children are thinking dystopias are cool. All the blockbuster, all the movies, all the big publishers will put their money behind dystopias. But there is enough contemporary literature happening in science fiction about what you can call realistic, hopeful futures. Right? For example, what springs to mind is this anthology called the Hieroglyph Anthology. You know, it's a project by Neil Stephenson. That's something that I would highly recommend. Have you heard of this magazine called The Verge? It's an American magazine. Yeah, so again, they realized that, listen, there's just too much gloom and doom going out. So they reached out to all these authors like John Scalzi and all of that with one mandate: build better futures. So it's those are sort of multimedia narrative stories. It's available as videos and it's available online for free. So if you just search for better worlds, from The Verge, you will see that. Then there is another book from the MIT review, right, called 12 Tomorrows. Again, where authors like Elizabeth Baer, Ken Liu and all, imagine near futures, not like 2100 or something like that, but 20 years down the line, about the impact of current technologies, right? And these are not, like I said, they're all realistic portrayals. So such, and then there's this new couple of new genres which are coming out called, while I hate labels, called hope punk and solar punk, and which talk about sustainable futures and all of that. So if you look for it, this literature is available. It's just that, you know, they don't have critical mass and they've not caught the popular imagination of these big publishers and studios just often get ignored. So it's there. So Verges, Better Worlds, it's free to read. There's amazing stories. Like there's this one amazing story where there's general inequality because only so many people can go to Mars. So this woman just sort of hacks the system by making rocket making, you know, open source. And next thing you have all these people building rockets in their backyard before anybody can do, they're all in Mars. And the Mars Constitution says that anybody who lands here has to be given citizenship. Right? So just look for The Verge, Better Worlds, Neil Stephenson's Hieroglyph Anthology, MIT's 12 Tomorrows, Lookout, Solarpunk Stories. They are all about hopeful futures. And it's stories in which, you know, typically, and they lived happily ever after. Right?
I'd like to add something here, which is that the reason dystopias work is because we have ideals that they are not living up to. So very fundamentally, I would argue that any dystopia only works if your reader has some ideals somewhere.
Very true. And as a general rule of thumb, I mean, in case anybody is planning to write anything among you, anything fictional, like if you do a story which is only happy and there's no problem, I don't think you'll get a publisher or anything. I mean, like, basically, you only have a story if there is a problem, you know, if there's bad stuff happening. And the more bad stuff you can put in your story, the more likely it's going to be successful.
Hi, I have a question. I want to know whether there is any parallel that we can draw among the concepts that were dealt in the films like April and the Extraordinary World, Snowpiercer and High Rise.
Could you repeat that?
Yeah. Is there any parallel that we can draw from the films April and the Extraordinary World, Snowpiercer and High Rise?
Okay.
Have we all seen all three? No,
yeah.
I've seen Snowpiercer.
Seen all three. I mean, April and the Extraordinary World is the steampunk one that you're talking about, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, all these three, in a sense, don't quite fall into the same category. Because Snowpiercer is a post-apocalyptic, self-contained narrative, right? It belongs to that genre. And the train becomes their world. Right, it just rips off from Christopher Priest's book, which they didn't pay for also. April and the Extraordinary World, on the other hand, is alternate history, right? Which you would be more qualified to talk about, where one thing has changed. It's steampunk, you know, and they're trying to escape and all that sort of a thing. High Rise, again, falls into the sort of dystopia, sort of broad contours and all. The only thing that all have in common is that they address, like any good science fiction or speculative fiction, the present, comment on the present and the need to escape and the need to make the world a better place or to make do with what power structures and inequalities and all of those things. So why these three? I mean, you take any novel, like we were saying that all there are about 8 plot points in this thing. You take any of the good Miyazaki movies or any of the other movies that have been coming up. They all follow the same themes and patterns.
Yeah, speaking of this actually, and also speaking of, similarities in these kind of plots, and speaking of Snowpiercer in particular, there is this theory that someone floated on YouTube, and there's several articles and entire videos about, you know, 20 minute videos about this odd parallel that exists between Charlie and the Chocolate Factory and Snowpiercer. And it's amazing. You must look it up, because it follows, I mean, they've plotted both the stories one below the other, and it follows the exact same beats. And the person has basically eventually concluded that the, you know, the Ed Harris character in Snowpiercer is essentially Charlie Bucket having grown up, and he's the one who's running the train now. And it's based on, you know, what he learned at the factory and, you know, Willy Wonka's whole weirdness and all of that. But it's just the weirdest thing. But once you read about it and watch it, it's you just can't unsee it.
Unsee it.
It's just...
You see, the other way of looking at fiction when you're comparing things is to separate the theme and separate the setting. Right? So if you're talking about power struggles and all that, that is the theme, which is there in Snowpiercer. It is also there in 1984. But the setting is different. Right? So that's the reason I bring about is to look at the commonalities. So is it a commonality of theme or is it a commonality of setting? So you'll have the same steampunk setting but with different themes. or you will have a what do you call the same theme but in different settings, maybe urban, maybe fantasy, right? Maybe in the future, maybe about a spaceship, right? If you look about you look at the stories of generation ships like Aurora from Kim Stanley Robinson, which is the gold standard by me. Same thing, same theme as Snowpiercer and all, but different setting.
I think we can take one last question, maybe.
We could. I mean, we have time.
We have another. I think Zach has to leave soon, but if the rest of us can stick around, maybe we can. Go on.
So my question is not related to fiction in general, but supposing now in the setting you told, right? Like we have a setting today where we are imagining that solar power is going to create a better future. But that's what we would have imagined 25 years earlier for borewell or for hydroelectricity or something else. So what we end up doing in doing high-tech, low-tech, whatever we do is to create more and more forms of things which will complicate the system which is already there. I mean, it might not necessarily happen, but is happening in general if we say from the engineering of water or whatever we have been doing. In that sense, the dystopia and utopia is so very... just what your perception is, the representation of space, representational space, and the spatial practice, that whole triad, in between that we cannot stay. We have to stay in one of them.
When Shenoy brought up this point, I wanted to say this, that you know, when we talk about technological development, it's not like the technologies don't exist for many things to optimize our life, right? But there are many other factors that prevent it. Government, you know, governments and financial interests and trade. And so it's the reason why we don't end up implementing and optimizing technologies that could make our lives easier is because there are powers bigger than us that are not going to benefit from them. So it is in their interest to keep certain, you know, keep the status quo a certain way, which is why, you know, certain technologies don't get. And then you look at the opposite, like Elon Musk, and you know, who is clearly championing a certain kind of utopian vision, and that obviously because he also has the money to buy legislation, more or less, is being able to kind of, you know, find a realistic possibility, right?
Yeah. To add on, when I said that, you know, the setting and all that, it's never a finished an ending. So there's this guy called Friedrich Pohl, who was a science fiction author from the 60s and an amazingly influential editor. And one of his most favorite quotes is, good extrapolation, speculation, or good science fiction does not lie in predicting the automobile. It lies in predicting the traffic jam. Right?
Yeah.
So in terms of societal impact, in terms of its impact on people's lives, their daily lives, their commutes, their relationships. So it could be that what I spoke about solar panels and each home becoming a grid, that's just the starting point. Now, how does that impact your dealings with bureaucracy, for example? Right? How is that going to solve the issue of potholes? So that's just the starting point. Then as a imaginative storyteller and as a fiction writer, you start working out the other modalities of how it impacts lives, people, you know, the relationship and society and all of those things. Like I said, I you know, there's shades of gray in between.
Figured out, because if you think about it, I was reading this article online about how a lot of interesting science fiction is set in 2019, like Blade Runner. But we're a long way from fighting wars on Mars and having replicants and things like that.
Running Man.
Akira.
Running Man. Yeah. We're all set in 2019. I mean, Blade Runner is in November. But obviously, just going by the kind of clothes we are wearing, we're not in Blade Runner's world.
Thank you very much for a really interesting panel. When you were, I'm sorry, I'll stand up. When you were talking about kind of the hope punk literature, Stevenson's hieroglyphics, the 12 futures and so forth, you were pointing toward mostly Western authors. And I wonder if you, as a panel, have a sense for the kinds of contributions that Western authors are simply incapable of providing based on, you know, and I'm obviously by my accent American, but so everybody comes from particular cultural perspectives, and that means maybe there are things that folks from outside the US and the West have to contribute that, you know, those of us who are American really need to hear. And so I was wondering if you ever thought about those kinds of stories, what kinds of contributions might be possible, you know, from the local context.
So one thing that I could point to is a prototype of a video game that I made in 2014, which was basically looking at what it might mean to look at what Indian steampunk is. So if you look at steampunk, the kind of, you know, the generic kind of description of steampunk assumes colonialism, assumes Victorian power. And so what does that mean? Because obviously steampunk is built on the labor of the colonies, and that's something that we just tend to kind of ignore. So we were just looking at what it means to think about Indian steampunk, and what we realized, because we were working in Delhi when we were doing this game, was that all Indian cities, as we've just described, are kind of anachronic. So you have really old technologies living side by side by really high-end technologies. And so one of the Western paradigms that has gained a lot of popularity recently is this idea of media archaeology. So, you know, when we think about media, we think of it in stratified layers. But in India, it's flat, because we're still using letterpress, and we're, you know, using VR. So you know, when we were thinking about Indian steampunk, what we were kind of thinking about is just the profusion of technology on display at any given time, and how any of those technologies can be harnessed to create something radical. And that obviously opens up all your potentials, because, you know, you could maybe try and do something with letterpress, but you could also do something with, I don't know, a hadron collider or whatever. So I think, you know, kind of taking kind of paradigms that we've learned from, or keep seeing, like tropes that have been popular in Western fiction or just Western thinking, and then kind of thinking how would that unfold in our context is just a useful thought experiment to kind of move towards that. So
yeah, I'd like to address your question in sort of two parts. The first part being that yes, Indian science fiction, I mean, there needs to be good Indian science fiction from an Indian context, but unfortunately that's not happening because the publishers are still encouraging Mahabharata fan fiction. Right? So again, follows the money, it follows the thing, you know, an artist and a writer needs to eat, needs to get his money. So till the time publishers and all, and it is in your hands, you can encourage it by picking up good science fiction anthologies and stories like the one which Vinayak has just edited, because that tells the publishers that there is a demand for it, and so we'll get better Indian science fiction from an Indian author in an Indian context, right? That's one part.
And actually,
the second part,
to add to that, there is, you know, there are those kind of stories that are happening increasingly now. I think, you know, I do think that this idea that, you know, we are largely mythology driven is, I think we're kind of slowly leaving that behind.
We're slowly leaving, but we need to accelerate that pace.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
All of you, as all of us as readers, can do that, right? By buying the book which tells the publishers that. For example, on the 28th of this month, there's an anthology, a Golan's anthology. It's called the Golan's Anthology of South Asian Science Fiction, featuring loads of Indian authors. Buy it. Then you'll get more Indian science fiction.
It looks beautiful, by the way. It looks
really
good.
So that's part one of your question, sir. The second part is that even when it comes to the hieroglyph anthology, right, it is an anthology of stories, and it even has a story by Vandana Singh, who is an Indian, right? He's an amazing Indian proper science fiction, speculative fiction author, right? Her new collection called Ambiguity Machines was just published a couple of months ago from Zuban. It's available for like 300 rupees. Vandana Singh is there in the hieroglyph anthology. Similarly, the other anthologies, there are representations from Southeast Asia and, you know, South Asia and so on and so forth. The third part is, when you're talking about extrapolation of technology and all of that, technology in these stories has been democratized, right? So the Facebook addiction of a teenager in India is the same as the Facebook addiction of a teenager in the US, right? So if I write a story about a smart home kidnapping the owner, holding him hostage till he transfers money, will be relatable to everybody, whether he's in Bangalore or whether he's in, you know, Bangkok or Brussels. So I hope that answers
There is a long and distinguished history of Indian science fiction, actually, which does, so, you know, there's a lot of, and also in Indian languages, so there is a lot of good science fiction in Bengali, in Malayalam, Tamil, in Marathi, in all kinds of languages around Kannada.
In Kannada.
Absolutely. I didn't mention it because I haven't read any yet, and I haven't read any translations as well. So maybe that's something you could shed some light on as well.
I mean,
maybe, you know, give some examples of what people could pick up.
Yeah, so generally when you talk of Indian speculative fiction, it's usually sort of mytho-fiction is the general thing. But if you look at pure tech, societal implications of technologies and all, as a definition of science fiction, it has been driven in India, not in English literature, but in regional literature. For example, in Tamil, you have this author called Sujata, right? Amazing science fiction stories, some of them are available in translation. It was his story that Endiran was based on. Right? And
a lot of these stories exist in pulp magazines, right?
And so in pulp magazines and all of that. So, that's there. The first proper Indian science fiction story was by Jagadish Chandra Bose. Right? Bengal has a huge tradition of good science fiction writing. So, in Karnataka, for example, there's this gentleman called Professor Bose Nurmat, who we knew as Rabu. He wrote a lot of science fiction in Kannada. In Maharashtra, you can look out for the English translations of Jayant Narlikar, the astrophysicist. So he writes a lot of science fiction. And most of them have been translated into English now. And then
he has this amazing, Shalini had done a comic adaptation of this book, and Rajiv Aip is here somewhere, and Rajiv Aip illustrated it. Right. So Rajiv illustrated this book, the comic, and it's there's a story called A Message from Aristarchus, and it's a sort of inversion of the Superman mythos, which is in which you have this baby from a dying planet that sort of lands up on Earth, I think in somewhere in Maharashtra, I think, and it's picked up by a couple of local people and, you know, raised there and so on, and then what this guy does when he grows up, and he, you know, finds out eventually that he's, you know, alien and has strange powers and so on. And eventually he uses the SETI project to signal to his race of aliens and precipitates an invasion, which is, you know, not what Superman is supposed to have done. But yeah.
Yeah. And then there is science fiction Nasamis by Dinesh Chandra Goswami, right? Another lady, her name is Sukanya Datta. She's a scientist and she works at CSIR. She's got like anthology. Her chosen field is biology and anthropology. She's got two or three anthologies already out called Tales from the Blue Planet and all of those things. So Sukanya Datta, these are all Indian authors which, because they don't primarily write in English and they don't move in what you consider the sort of lit fest crowd, the Assamese know about Dinesh Chandra Goswami. Tamilians know about Sujata. Kannadigas know about Rabu. But with translations, thankfully now, otherwise I would not have known about Sujata or been able to read Dinesh Chandra Goswami. So, it's
out
there.
You should support the small press because, you know, look at publications like, publishers like Blaft, for instance, which is, it's not widely distributed, but it's doing, I mean, those guys are doing extraordinary work and, you know, translating and putting out regional pulp fiction. So, it's all genre fiction. You have zombies and you have, you know, evil killer robots and all kinds of things from, you know, set in places like Chennai and wherever, and it's just incredible, and they're being translated, they're being sold, but unfortunately you often will be able to find it only on their websites or in certain bookstores. But please find, you know, the small press book publishers and, you know, buy books off them, because you'll find amazing stuff there, just incredible.
Or for that matter, the science fiction of Satyajit Ray.
Right.
Brilliant stuff.
Absolutely,
brilliant stuff.
Yeah.
And if it had come to that, I mean, he would have made the alien movie. He just got shafted by this skin diver turned guru and all of those things, and then Spielberg generally quietly ripped off and made it into E.T.
A lot of the Shanku stories are sci-fi, right?
All of Professor, right? Shanku is
right.
Sci-fi.
I read it so long ago, I don't remember now anymore. But yeah, but there is a lot of Bengali science fiction, actually. There's a hell of a lot of, and comics as well. That's right.
My dream is that Bengal had this amazing tradition of science fiction magazines modeled on Amazing and Astounding,
right.
You know, like Odbhut and all of those. Someday I hope somebody decides to translate them so that, you know, I could also read it.
So if there are any translators please in note. The audience, please. I think we can, are we, how are we on time? Should we wrap up or? I think Zach has to leave as well. So I thank you all for coming and thanks to this wonderful panel. Shunando, Padmini, Zach, Shalini and Gautam Shenoy. We've had a fairly fun conversation. Thank you so much all of you for coming and it's been a great pleasure.